Strange laws. Well, maybe they will. Some of these will strike you as being a bit severe. If a man seduces a virgin who is not pledged to be married and sleeps with her, he must pay the bride price and she shall be his wife. If her father absolutely refuses to give her to him, he must still pay the bride price for virgins. We've looked previously, and I'm not going to go into it all again, when one of the laws we looked at a few times ago was that the only place, as far as God is concerned, for sexual intercourse is within marriage. We saw that very, very clearly. Sex is good, God created it, but it is for within marriage only, not for elsewhere. And we looked at that and the reasons for that in detail before, so we're not going to unpack that now. But here, this law, particularly in the context of that society, which was a very male-dominated society, this law protects women. It actually gives women rights that in all the surrounding nations and societies, they did not have.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called What Matters to God? Exodus chapter 22, verses 1 to 31, by Pastor David Wise.
Father God, it's been a great morning this morning to have been in your presence, to have worshipped you, to have spent a lot of time thanksgiving for all the different things you've done, for answers to prayer, for seeing Wads and I baptized this morning and celebrating with her. Father God, thank you for all of that. Thank you that you are here, that you are among us, that you are an active God. Thank you. And as we come now to look at your words, we ask that you will speak to us. Father, as we look at passages that in some ways are a bit strange, we ask that you will help us to understand and understand what it is you're saying to us. We thank you that your word is a living word. It's not a dead word from years ago. It's a living word from today. We ask that you'll speak to us through it this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're looking this morning at Exodus 22, as you can see. And just to remind you that the book of Exodus and the things that are there, it's probably the most significant book in the Old Testament. It's foundational to everything that follows in the Old Testament, and it also is foundational to lots of things in the New. And currently we're working through a section of Exodus that deals with a lot of laws. And some of them we will look at today, and some of them we looked at last time, at first sight don't seem to be relevant to us. They're about situations that we don't face in Greenford. But as we've been working through, we've seen that the principles that are behind these laws are hugely relevant to us. They affect us today, our lives today. So we're going to be looking at that as we work through this morning. But first of all, we're going to revise what we did 2 weeks ago. Who was here 2 weeks ago? Very good. The level of honesty is increasing. What were the key things? We looked 2 weeks ago at chapter 21 and a whole range of issues. There are a lot of things about bulls, if you remember, and all sorts of other things as well. What were the principles? What were the things that we took away that came out of that, that spoke into our situation from 2 weeks ago? What do you remember? Bosse?
Treating people equally.
Okay, so looking at one, treating everybody equally. Yeah, very good. What else? Joe?
I just remember you saying how God's laws
for the Peak River as well were very just compared to the surrounding nations. Yeah. And set an example of what?
There was an example of justice. There was a humanity in the laws there, particularly in the way that slaves and servants were treated, for example. There was a justice there that simply was not around elsewhere. So, yeah. What else? Yeah. Leslie.
About honouring your mother and father, what that actually meant, that it wasn't literally just... it was like wishing them ill, the death to come to them more than... just what it's written.
Okay, yeah, so this was this thing about cursing, that you know, the cursing parents and so on, that it was actually wishing them really ill, and that God, because the whole thing of parenthood is foundational to society, and God was against that completely, yeah. What else? There were some other really important things, including the title from last time, which was, which you can't see in your text in front of you, which was quite important. Anybody remember what the title was for 2 weeks ago? It was All of Life. Do you remember that we looked at that actually God is concerned with all of our lives? Every part, every aspect, God is concerned for all of our lives. Every area. And we also, as it was touched on here, God caring about the weak in society and God's passion for justice. So we come to the passage for today. We're going to go through the first part, just to help you know how we're going to deal with this. The first part of the chapter we're going to move through relatively quickly, because there are some really important principles that come out later in the chapter. So we're going to go through the first part quite fast. But we will work at it as we go through. So chapter 22, beginning at verse 1. If a man steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters it or sells it, he must pay back 5 head of cattle for the ox and 4 sheep for the sheep. If a thief is caught breaking in and is struck so that he dies, the defender is not guilty of bloodshed, but if it happens after sunrise, he is guilty of bloodshed. A thief must certainly make restitution, but if he has nothing, he must be sold to pay for his theft. If the stolen animal is found alive in his possession, whether ox or donkey or sheep, he must pay back double. If a man grazes his livestock in a field or vineyard and lets them stray and they graze in another man's field, he must make restitution from the best of his own field or vineyard. If a fire breaks out and spreads into thorn bushes so that it burns shocks of grain or standing corn or the whole field, the one who started the fire must make restitution. Well, this is a whole variety of laws that deal with a range of different situations where someone has taken something that belongs to somebody else. That's the common theme through these 6 verses, and actually down to verse 15. Just a couple of observations as we go through. Whether or not the crime was planned, or whether it was something which was done, if you like, on the spur of the moment, affects the degree of punishment. This is why, you know, if the animal's been disposed of or slaughtered, it looks like, well, this was something that was planned. Whereas if he's found still with it, not sure what to do with it, it looks like more like an opportunistic crime. And the penalties are different for that. This rather strange expression about the person coming into your house, that is caught breaking in. Actually, the word, the Hebrew word there, is digging in. And it's because they lived in houses that were made of mud bricks. So you could literally dig through the wall of the house. And it makes the point here is that, you know, if someone is digging, you find someone digging through your wall in the middle of the night, and in all the confusion that is there, you can't see the person, you don't know whether they're armed, you don't know what's going on, and the person dies in the ensuing whatever, from God's sight, that's okay. But if that person is breaking in during the daylight, digging through the wall of your house, when everything can be clearly seen and help can be summoned much more easily during daylight, and you kill them, then actually that is murder. What's interesting about that is that, and we might come back to this later on, is that even the criminal into the house is protected by God's law. Let's go on, verse 7. If a man gives his neighbour silver or gold for safekeeping, and they are stolen from the neighbour's house, the thief, if he is caught, must pay back double. But if the thief is not found, the owner of the house must appear before the judges to determine whether he has laid his hands on the other man's property, i.e., as he put it in his pocket, and said, oh, someone has stolen it. In all cases of illegal possession of an ox, a donkey, a sheep, a garment, or any other property about which someone says, this is mine, both parties are to bring their cases before the judges. The one whom the judges declare guilty must pay back double to his neighbour. If a man gives a donkey, an ox, a sheep, or any other animal to his neighbour for safekeeping, and while it dies or is injured or is taken while no one is looking, the issue between them will be settled by the taking of an oath before the Lord that the neighbour did not lay hands on the other person's property. The owner is to accept this, and no restitution is required. But if the animal was stolen from the neighbour, he must make restitution to the owner. If it was torn to pieces by a wild animal, he'll bring in the remains as evidence, and he will not be required to pay for the torn animal. If a man borrows an animal from his neighbour and it's injured or dies while the owner is not present, he must make restitution. But if the owner is with the animal, the borrower will not have to pay. And if the animal was hired, the money paid for the hire covers the loss. A whole string again of different situations, most of which, you know, in Greenford we don't very often borrow our neighbour's donkey. But some of the principles behind this are important. So let's think about these first 15 verses. Let's reflect back over them. And what are some of the principles that would apply from this in our context here in West London in 2008? What are some of the things? Because as we've seen, these laws reflect God's values and God's heart. What are some of the things that we can take out of these verses in our situations? Leslie.
Well, the last verse, it's like if you go and hire a van or a car for the day, and everything, that makes clear sense in today's laws, because obviously you're going to put down your down payment and then you're not going to have to pay back.
Yep.
You know, money is if it gets damaged or
yep.
whatever. But if it's like a friend's and you borrow it, that's a different story.
Yeah, yeah. Very good. That transferable directly into our context, isn't it? Except it's cars, not donkeys. Okay, what else? Other things are there? Rangina, yeah.
Judgment should be through the courts, the law, yeah, rather than someone actually taking vengeance on something.
Yeah, that's very interesting, because this society was if you like, a newly organised society. So that, you know, they were just coming into being as a nation. And so there is that tendency in those situations for people to take justice into their own hands. But everything here is determined before the judges. And the judges are people who've been appointed by God, you know, through there, and they have been given authority. And it's very clear that it's not about people taking vengeance or taking things back. You know, I come to Frank's house and look and say, I used to have, that's mine that you've got in your house. And rather than, you know, Frank and I having a fight over it, which of course I would lose being
half
so
size.
Small, half the size. Yeah, I was just going to hesitate then, but half the size. You see, it's something which you take before the judges. And you then accept the judgment of the judges. There is that whole thing there, that protection that is there against the taking of personal vengeance, taking the law into your own hands. The whole judicial system is there. Anything else? Yes, Anita.
Following on from what Roger was saying about vengeance, God says, vengeance is mine and I will repay. And God is a God of order. and discipline according to his commandments.
Yep. Yes, we see that here. God is a God of order and discipline. Last comment, Frank.
I just say, you see, it looks fair, the justice, and today's justice is considered. It's not, you know, it is considered. People bring the evidence and can state their case, and mitigating circumstances can be brought. Yeah. So it's
because in fact, our justice system in the UK, with all its, you know, I'm not saying it's perfect, but the principles of that are based directly on this legal system from the Old Testament. So our justice system in the UK, the way that it is structured, or that comes out of this system here, about people standing before judges, arguing the case, each having the opportunity to say their piece, and witnesses and all of that, it actually is taken from this, not just these laws, but the principles that are there in the Old Testament. And there is that whole thing of fairness. And it doesn't matter whether you're a really rich person or a really poor person. The judges are actually warned elsewhere not to be swayed by rich people. There is that impartiality. Justice is available to all, irrespective of who they are. Okay, let's move on. Come to some strange laws. Well, maybe they will. Some of these will strike you as being a bit severe. If a man seduces a virgin who is not pledged to be married and sleeps with her, he must pay the bride price and she shall be his wife. If her father absolutely refuses to give her to him, he must still pay the bride price for virgins. We've looked previously, and I'm not going to go into it all again, when one of the laws we looked at a few times ago was that the only place, as far as God is concerned, for sexual intercourse is within marriage. We saw that very, very clearly. Sex is good, God created it, but it is for within marriage only, not for elsewhere. And we looked at that and the reasons for that in detail before, so we're not going to unpack that now. But here, this law, particularly in the context of that society, which was a very male-dominated society, this law protects women. It actually gives women rights that in all the surrounding nations and societies, they did not have. It gives them this right because once they had sex, they obviously were no longer a virgin and therefore could not marry in the normal way of that. Which meant they had nobody to provide for them because in those days, you know, there was no benefits, there was no system for them to be cared for. So here the man is made to take responsibility. You have sex with a virgin, that person is then your responsibility. You pay the bride price, you marry them, you look after them. And it's interesting that God actually puts this in the law book because God takes this whole issue very seriously. And around us there are cultures where men in their sexual conduct do not take responsibility. It's quite an issue. Around us in our society, in some of the cultures that are represented around us. But it is crystal clear here that the man is to take responsibility. I mean, if he is an absolutely terrible person and a father says, there is no way I'm going to allow my daughter to marry such a person, still, there has to be the financial payment. So there is here this protection that is there. Let's look at the next one. Do not allow a sorceress to live. I'd like you to turn over with me. Keep your finger in there. We're coming back to Exodus in a moment. But this is expanded a little over in Deuteronomy 18. And I want to take you there. Deuteronomy chapter 18. You'll find it on page 197. When you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you, do not learn to imitate the detestable ways of the nations there. Let no one be found among you who sacrifices his son or daughter in the fire, who practices divination or sorcery, interprets omens, engages in witchcraft, who casts spells, or who is a medium, or spiritist, or who consults the dead. Anyone who does these things is detestable to the Lord. And because of these detestable practices, the Lord your God will drive out those nations before you. You must be blameless before the Lord your God. The nations you will dispossess listen to those who practice sorcery or divination. But as for you, the Lord your God has not permitted you to do this. The Lord your God will rise up for you a prophet like me from among your own brothers. You must listen to him. And those things in that list there would include things that are really prevalent in our society, like horoscopes, for example. Interpreting of omens, horoscopes, all of that stuff, it's all mixed in there. So what is it about these things that is so serious? In Exodus it says, someone who practices sorcery should not even be allowed to live. In Deuteronomy you've got that list there which we just read of those detestable practices, which is, in God's vocabulary, one of the strongest terms he can use. What is it about these things that is so serious? Because in our society around us here, most of these things are practiced. So what is it that makes this so serious? I saw a hand at the back there. I didn't see whose it was. It was yours, Leslie, yeah.
Well, you don't know where it's coming from, basically. You don't know, whether it's coming directly from God, and where the person's getting their information from a lot of the time. And there's nobody actually to confirm where their heart is.
Mm. I would see it slightly differently, actually. I think the trouble is we do know where it's coming from,
right,
in that it's not coming from God.
Right. Well, there you go.
Yeah, you know exactly which source it's coming from, yeah. But the issue here is that it's not coming from God. Mm. So someone is actually turning to somebody other than God for guidance, which is dangerous for reasons we'll no doubt unpack in a moment. Susan?
To add on that, it's dealing with unfamiliar spirits. And I think as a Christian, if you do this, you actually open up yourself to unfamiliar spirits which come into your life, which they're not godly. They're demonic. Okay. And I think you tamper with the terrible word.
Right, so if we get involved in this, we're saying that there are, what you've used the phrase, unfamiliar spirits. Other people might use the phrase evil spirits. Spirits that aren't of God, spirits that are contrary to the Holy Spirit. And if we get involved in these practices, we can open our lives to their influence. Yeah, okay, very good. Anita?
Also, God says he will not share his glory or his works with anyone else. And to get involved in these sort of things without people knowing it, they might think they're just doing something wrong, but behind it could also be opening themselves up to devil worship and glorifying the devil.
That's a very important point, actually, because in doing one of the key things here, God is saying, I give you prophets. Mm. You can listen to the prophets. I give you people to bring my word to you. And if you're going to these other sources, you're actually going outside of God.
Yes.
And God will not share his glory with another. That's a very good point. Akin.
It takes the focus away from God, and your mind's sort of going in different directions while there are consequences of God.
Okay, so it takes your focus away from God, you get involved in all these other things rather than God alone. Yeah. There's more here as well. I want to dig deeper. Rangina.
God should be the central in our lives and we should be trusting him. If we go to all these different things, it's of the devil, we know that. And we're going and trying to get somebody else's interpretation or future of our own lives.
Okay, so at the very least, we're showing a lack of faith in God. If we are going to one of these other sources, at the very, very least, I think it's more serious than that, but we're showing a lack of faith in God. We're saying we're not trusting God for the future. We're trying to get a view of the future through some other route, which is an act of unbelief, a lack of faith in God. It's more serious than that, but that's it at the very least. Mark?
It can be very misleading. People put the faith in it and they give them the wrong information. They go down different paths.
Yeah, it's misleading because Satan is the father of lies and all that is false. You start engaging with any of these other sources and the stuff that is coming to you, it can be lies and deception. And Satan is not wanting the best for your lives. Yeah, Carol.
Well, just an observation, really. Some, you know, people in our society say, oh, you know, but this person, this medium, this clairvoyant told me this and told me that, and it was true. You know, yeah, there can be some, there is some supernatural power. And people in this day and age, they confuse supernatural power with God. Just because it's supernatural doesn't mean it's from God.
Yeah, that's a very important point. I mean, we would look at some of the mediums and stuff that goes on and say this is charlatans. Yeah. This is people that really haven't got. Yeah. But there is also mixed in with that real spiritual power. Satan is a powerful spiritual being, and so there is that counterfeit. And we can, you know, it's just because somebody says, well, it's true, it doesn't mean it's of God. Now, you look at the things that Satan said to Jesus when he was tempting Jesus. They were all true. Every statement that Satan said to Jesus, the first half was true. It was what he did with it afterwards that was so wrong. But the first half was true. And so just because it's true, it doesn't mean it's of God. Yeah. Thank you. Akin.
It means you're not trusting God's ability to deal with certain things. And that's the reason why you go seeking.
Yeah. It's a lack of, so when we as Christians, if we as Christians do any of these things, it is because we don't trust God, basically. We lack trust and faith in God. Yeah, Hannah.
And also God commanded us to worship Him and worship Him alone. By going that way, it's like you're actually worshiping other gods and following that line of worship.
Yeah, we're worshiping other gods. We are not keeping to God alone. Finally, is two more. Is Matt, then Rachel.
From the area I came in the Middle East, I mean, people, when they go to future tellers, and beside the money they pay them, because they live on this money, they ask them to offer sacrifice. So beside the money, always they ask them to either bring sheep with them or to bring chickens. So in a way, they are offering sacrifice to the demons, to Satan.
Okay, so in your culture that you came from in Iraq, this actually involves worship of other gods. Going to the future tellers, the fortune tellers, as we would call them here, the future tellers is the phrase you've used. It actually specifically involved worship of other gods, which we understand to be demonic. Yeah, okay, finally, Rachel.
Maybe slightly tech, but the whole thing of birth signs and all that, it's like, God made us individuals and special, and we're individual, and God made us special, and that takes that all away. It's like, well, there's 12 different types of people, or however many different signs there are, and, you know, if you're that sign, you are like that, whatever. And it just, I don't know, God's made us special and individual, and it takes all that away.
Yes, absolutely. We've been made individual in God, and our futures are not determined by a series of astrological signs. There are two things that I want to sort of underline here. I mean, both come out of the thing that this is serious. Now, in our society, people see some of this stuff as play. Now, at the Greenford Carnival, just a few doors down from us, if you excuse the expression, a few tents down from us, you know, there was a fortune teller. And one of our church members got actually quite angry, because they'd been caught up in this stuff in the past. And they went and they actually spent a chunk of the time talking very nicely to the people in the queue for the fortune teller, explaining the truth of the gospel, which I thought was actually great. Very good. Very good. And it was because they saw how dangerous this is. So this is serious stuff. So there are two things. Firstly, as Christians, if you get involved in anything to do with this, you are opening yourself up to demonic attack big time. I mean, you might as well just lay down and say, Satan, come and kick me. You know, because that's what you're doing. If you get involved in any of this stuff at all, as Christians, you ought to know better. You really ought to know better. And it is a lack of faith in God. It's a lack of trust in God. It's a lack of belief that God guides you and speaks to you. The second thing is that people around us outside of Jesus, you may have friends and relatives, work colleagues, acquaintances that are getting involved in this sort of stuff. And you should warn them. that this is, to quote a phrase that was used many years ago, these are doorways to danger. Doorways to danger. People think that stuff like Halloween and all of that, you know, is fun. It's a doorway to danger. Now, the reason that God detests it is because it is destructive to people. God wants the very, very best for us. And he wants to keep harm and danger out of our lives. And he detests this because this opens routes for Satan to destroy people's lives. I mean, I could stand here and tell you stories of people that we've had come to the church here, that we've had to pray with and help through, whose lives have been really messed up by getting heavily involved in this sort of stuff. God sorted them out. God straightened them out. Dangerous, destructive. That's why it is so serious. Let's move on to the next couple of verses. Big change here. Well, on the surface, a big change, but actually it's two of the same things. Anyone who has sexual relations with an animal must be put to death. Anyone who sacrifices to any other god other than the Lord must be destroyed. The reason that that is in the list here is not to do with sexual morality. It actually was a part of worship in Canaanite in the Canaanite practice, the nations surrounding them. It was fertility rites. The whole thing of having sex with animals was a fertility rite. It was part of worship. So that's why it's in this list here. It isn't that, you know, coming out of sexual morality. This is coming out of worship, because this is worship of other gods. And it's a way that it is or was in those days expressed. And again, there is this thing, it is God alone, God only. And there is here this temptation for the people of God to see the practices of people around them and be tempted to give them a try. You know, to go along to some of their worship feasts and get drunk and have sex with prostitutes. Or to go to some of their other sensual events. All this stuff is around there. It's all available. It's on offer. And God is saying, don't get drawn into that. And that's just like today, isn't it? You know, we're surrounded not with other nations. It's all mixed in with us. And God says, stay true to me. I want the best for you. Don't allow yourself to get drawn into any of this. Amen. Subject change. Verse 21. Do not treat an alien. Sorry, do not ill-treat an alien or oppress him, for you were aliens in Egypt. I want to explain the word alien, because when we hear it in English, we think of Martians. There were two sorts of foreigners in Israel. There were the aliens, and there were the foreigners. The aliens were those who were resident in Israel. The foreigners were those, they're two different Hebrew words. The foreigners were those that were not resident. Which is why you've got this expression that crops up from time to time. It's a resident foreigner. Now this verse 21 is a really, really important verse. Because it contains a really, really important principle that goes actually way beyond what you just see in this verse in front of you. See, the people of Israel had been powerless in Egypt. Remember, we looked at that story as how we worked through Exodus when we began. They were there, an oppressed people in Egypt. They were powerless. And now they have come into power. They now, who were powerless, because of God's intervention, find themselves in power. But they were to remember what it was like for them previously, and to let it guide them in how they should treat others. Now, brothers and sisters, as Christians, before Christ found us, many of us, not all of us, but many of us, lives were a right mess. You've heard the testimonies from the front here, some of the baptisms we've seen in the last couple of years. You've read others in the church magazine, sort of lives that people we've been seeing coming to faith and growing in God here, the lives that people have come from. Among the weak, the marginalised, the vulnerable, criminal, all sorts. And when we get our lives a bit sorted, well, I'll change that. When God gets our lives a bit sorted, it can be too easy for us to begin to look down on other people and to forget where we were. And God always has a heart for people. This is not a biblical phrase, this next one, but God always has a heart for people at the bottom of the pile. God has been accused of being biased for the poor, and I think God is guilty of that. He cares for those at the bottom of the pile. And we, who may not be at this time at the bottom of the pile, the fact that we're here this morning indicates we probably are not. We need to remember where we have come from, and we need to be looking out for other people, not ill-treating or oppressing people at all. When I come back in a few moments to ask you what you see out of these verses, I want you to remember that in our global culture, those that we may be oppressing may not be people who live next door to us in Greenford, but they may be people who live in some other part of the world. And when I come to ask you in a few moments' time, what are the principles that we see here for our lives? I want you to think not just about your next door neighbour in Greenford, but actually to think globally, because we are part of a small world where we are hugely interconnected. But let's read these next five verses and then let's think about how this works for us. These are all examples of what it means not to ill-treat or oppress. Do not take advantage of a widow or an orphan. In their social context, the widows and the orphans were the people that had nobody to speak for them. They had no male in that strongly male-dominated society. They had no male to speak for them, no male to claim their rights for them. They were the people without a voice in that context. So you might want to think, what's the equivalent in our world? Who are the people in our world? Not in Greenford. Who are the people in our world today who are the equivalent of the widows or orphans? The people that do not have a voice. Do not take advantage of a widow or an orphan. If you do and they cry out to me, I will certainly hear their cry. My anger will be aroused and I will kill you. This is addressed to God's people, by the way. I will kill you with the sword. Your wives will become widows and your children fatherless or orphans. If you lend money to one of my people among you who is needy, do not be like a moneylender, charge him no interest. If you take your neighbour's cloak as a pledge, return it to him by sunset, because his cloak is the only covering he has for his body. This cloak was the main garment that was worn. And at night it acted as a blanket that protected you against the cold nights. During the day, you actually carried your stuff around in it. You didn't wear it during the day. You carried your stuff because it's hot and sunny in Palestine during the day and cold at night. So it was a vital piece of kit. And for a poor person, it was the only possession they had of any value, which is why it could be taken as a pledge, which is why God addresses it here in the way he does. The cloak is the only covering he has. What else will he sleep in? When he cries out to me, I will hear, for I am compassionate. Commentators, we referred to this earlier on, but commentators note that these laws are all without parallel in any of the surrounding nations at that time. Came across this quote from a writer called Pixley. He wrote this: basic human rights arise from basic human needs. Misery is not to be trafficked in. Basic human rights arise from basic human needs. Misery is not to be trafficked in. That's his comment on these verses. So, let's think about our context now. How do these principles apply to us? Who might they apply to? Who are the people without a voice? Who are the needy? What are the principles here? How do they apply in our context, in our world today? I want us to take a few minutes to think about this. This is a really important principle that is here. Susan.
Well, the people without a voice, I think for countries where they have dictators and the people who don't have a say whatsoever.
Okay.
And contributing to the country where what the leaders say, that's law, whether you like it or not.
Okay, so one of the groups without a voice are people who are oppressed in countries where there are dictators that do not allow the people to speak. Yeah. And often they keep their people in poverty as well. Andy.
To be careful when you say buy clothes from somewhere that they've got sweatshops and things like that.
Yeah.
They have to work there. They can't not work there.
Yeah, this is one of the issues about what we do here. As I've made the comment before, for those of us who are in this congregation, we are among the richest in the world. But what we do with our money actually affects other people. So when we buy stuff, if we look at something and think, that is really cheap, I'll have some of that, that actually we could be oppressing other people. Because the fact that this T-shirt costs 75p, what has happened to the people that have made that? It's why one of the issues for us as Christians is the whole issue of fair trade and why fair trade is so important. At the tea and coffee you had in connection time here, it was fairly traded tea and coffee. We only use fair trade products here. And we encourage people to buy fair trade because that guarantees that the people that are on the end of that, involved in the production, are being properly looked after. Thank you, Andy. Yeah. Denzel.
What Susan was saying about people who are oppressed in another country, often when they come here, become refugees or asylum seekers, they are treated very poorly, very, very often, and have no rights.
Yeah. So those people that come from overseas that come here as asylum seekers. This talks about our responsibility as a society in caring for asylum seekers, for people without a voice. And as you say, our society is at times not been very good at that, the way that
perhaps
it is handled.
They are foreigners who are living here.
Yes, they become foreigners who are living here. Yeah, they are aliens in the terms here. Yeah, Janet.
I was going to say the homeless, they don't have a voice. They have no choice of anything.
Okay, so people who are homeless in our own capital here, they don't have a voice. People have responsibility for. Yes.
People like in third world countries from other religions, like in Iraq, Islam, and various countries where women are not connected with equal rights. They just only let the men work. The women are supposed to stay at home and look after the children and things like that.
So in some countries it is women who are voiceless and powerless.
Yes.
And we have responsibility there. Yeah, okay. What else?
I think in this country people can be disadvantaged or perceived as weaker, maybe if they're older, if they don't have much family to speak for them, if they have disabilities, they often might feel voiceless.
Okay. So some of the other people here, you're saying, are people who are elderly, particularly those without family to speak for them, and people who are disabled and don't have someone to speak for them. Yeah, very good.
Economic migrants. Those people who come to the UK, who are often coming from four countries, who come to the UK to work, looking for work, and then people exploit them because they have come and they're desperate for work, so people are exploiting them, not paying them, or just taking advantage of them.
All right, so the whole issue of people who are employed here who are not paid the minimum wage, who are not treated properly, and there have been in our newspapers over the last few months some horrendous accounts of some of the things that have happened to people from other parts of the world that are brought here, and how they have been exploited mercilessly. So what does it say about our priorities and our conduct as God's people? We pulled up a whole list of disadvantaged people. We pulled up a number of situations. What does it say about how we are to be as people in this world? Mark, yeah. Yeah, it's one of the principles there. Treat other people as you'd want to be treated yourself. Yeah. Yeah.
It's an attitude, really, to be mindful that of all the advantages and blessings that God has given us. And, you know, even that we know the Lord, it's just His mercy has opened our eyes. You know, we didn't save ourselves. You know, it was His Spirit drawing us to Him. And all the disadvantaged are also people who have never had an opportunity to know Christ in their families and their surroundings and their environment and their culture or subculture. They've never, you know, and God loves them. It was while we were dead in our sins that God saved us.
Excellent. I won't repeat any of that because it all went over the mic. That's excellent. Thank you, Carleen.
We should stop complaining and try to be more compassionate and think about other people, because I think people, they tend to complain a lot, getting that, you know, they're so blessed and, like you say, among the richest.
Yeah.
And they don't.
So people here complain about their lot. I mean, English people love complaining, don't they? You know, complain about the lot. We complain when it's sunny. We complain when it's wet.
No pleasing
at all, no. But also in the context here, you know, we can complain about our economic situation, forgetting that actually we have so much.
Yeah.
We have so much. Yeah, very good. Liz?
I think that probably being proactive and finding out ways that you can actually add your voice to lobby Parliament.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, so we shouldn't be just passive. As Christians, God calls us to be active. I mean, I got this expression. I think I use it later on in the... right at the end. God calls us to reflect His passion for poor. God is passionate for the poor. It's not a side issue for God. God is passionate for the poor, passionate about poverty, passionate about these issues. And we should be passionate. And passionate is about being active. Passionate is about getting involved. Passionate is about making a difference. Passionate is about lobbying our government. Because there are things in our world that actually it's not just about what I do with my money when I go shopping. It's about what our government does with its money in our world that makes a huge difference. And this whole thing here, this issue about loaning with interest. You look at some of the economic policies that some of the Western countries have had to some of the poorest countries in our world. When they've loaned them huge sums of money on the basis that they're going to buy stuff from us, and then we charge them huge amounts of interest. So we were in the situation for years where we, from the poorest countries in our world, the UK was receiving more in interest payments than we were giving them in aid. Which is why Christians got this Jubilee campaign together about the writing off of debts for the poorest countries in the world. And that's had impact. It's not gone as far as we want it to go, but it has had impact. It has made a difference. But these are issues that we should be involved with and we should be passionate about, not just sitting and thinking about it, but actually taking action about it. For some, it's about getting involved with lobbying organisations. There's a group called the World Development Movement, for example, which I've been a member of for about 25 years now. It's a campaigning group for those in poverty in our world. It's not a charity, has no charitable status, because it's a political campaigning group. It lobbies Parliament in the UK and in Europe and in the United Nations. And have a search online for it if you want to find out about it. The World Development Movement, recommend it to you. They're all the time having campaigns of one sort and another to persuade, and they've been very successful in some of their campaigns. And so for some of us, we need actually to really get involved in this thing. And when we come to vote in elections, the issues of what a party, particularly when it comes to national elections, the issue of what a party's policy is to do with those in the poorer parts of our world ought to matter to us. It's not about what we pay in taxation only. It's not about our schools only, our health service only. These are very selfish concerns. I'm not saying they shouldn't be issues for us, but they're very selfish issues. We should be looking to see what a party is saying about its doing. There is a commitment that every government that's a part of the UN of giving 0.7% of its GNP in aid to other countries. The UK has never achieved that. It's closer to it now than it's ever been in its history, but it's still never achieved it. And we need to be reminding the government. It was actually in the
manifesto.
The manifesto, that's right. The last government, the last election, it was in the Labour Party manifesto. So they've not done it yet, so we ought to be reminding them. But when it comes to those election things, we need to be looking at those issues as well. Because God cares. Because God is passionate for justice in our world. Justice for the poor, the powerless, the voiceless. And we should be passionate about that as well. Here's a quote I came across this week. One writer on Exodus. The intensely personal response of God. Notice how personal it is. God says, Ismat, if you don't care for the poor, for the widows and the orphans, you mistreat them, Ismat, your family will be orphans. And that's a very personal response. I mean, excuse me using you. I mean, you're part of the leadership, but you can take it. But you see, this is a very personal thing that God says here. This is not some general principle that God thinks might be appropriate. This is God saying, God takes this personally. The intensely personal response of God here lifts up the high importance of the way in which a society treats the poor. This matters. And we'll see this again and again in Exodus as we work through, and want to paint it in bold, bright brushstrokes for you to see this morning. Okay, let's move on for the last three verses in our remaining few minutes this morning. Verse 28, do not blaspheme God or curse the ruler of your people. Do not hold back offerings from your granaries or your vats. You must give me the firstborn of your sons. Do the same with your cattle and your sheep. Let them stay with their mothers for 7 days, but give them to me on the eighth day. You are to be my holy people. So do not eat the meat of an animal torn by wild beasts. Throw it to the dogs. That's because it would still have the blood in it. And you, as the people of God in the Old Testament, were not to eat the blood. The issue here for these people is not how they can become holy. The issue for us as God's people is not how we can become holy. The issue for them and for us is how we live our lives as holy people. This isn't about scoring points with God, about living good lives. It is about living our lives out. It says here, all of this, you are to be my holy people. And one of the implications of that, everything that we have belongs to God. Don't hold back the offerings from your granaries, your vats, your bank accounts. Actually, because it all belongs to God. Let's pull these things together as we've coming to the end of our time. What are the key things that we take away from this chapter this morning? What are the main things that we have learnt this morning? What are the key things, do you think? Recap time, yeah.
To care for poor and people disadvantaged in the world.
Care for the poor, disadvantaged in our world, yes. What else? Jane. Yeah, God's given us really clear rules how we should live as his people. Susan.
And that we should have faith in God for all things and not turn to different spirits.
We should trust God for everything. We don't need anything else. We shouldn't turn to anything else. Yes, Anita.
God wants to have a share in everything we own. It's loaned to us and everything we own, be it telephones, be it our bank account.
Yeah, everything we have belongs to God. Absolutely everything. Yeah, anything else? Three things that seem to me to be the key things. One we haven't mentioned here now, just the importance of respecting the judgment of those in authority. Not talking here about church leaders, the context of the courts. The fact that God views any occult activity of any sort very seriously, and that we should reflect God's passion in caring for the poor. Let's stand together. Let me pray for you as we finish our meeting this morning. Let me give you a few moments to make your own response to God, and then I'll lead us in prayer together. Father God, I want to thank you that your word is as relevant then as now. And thank you that your word, your will, affects every area and part of our lives, not just some bits, not just when we're together for a few hours on a Sunday, but the whole of our lives, every aspect of our life. And Father, I ask that you will help us to live out our holy lives as your people. Help us to share your passion, Father God. I ask you'll stir up your passion among us in caring for the poor. You would stir up our passion in caring for the poor. I pray that you'd help us to keep our lives centered on you alone, not to get drawn into any of the other stuff that is around. And you'd help us to help people around us stay free of dangerous activities, these doorways to danger. And so, Father God, as we go into this week, some this week returning to a more usual pattern of life with children starting back at school, some starting back at university this weekend, others later. Father, we commit this week into your hands. We ask that wherever, I ask for everyone here, that wherever they are this week, whatever place, whatever context, they're going to make a difference for you. Whether they're at home, whether they're at work, whether they're in an educational place, wherever they are, that they will be making a difference for you, and that you will be as close to every one of us here, 11 o'clock on Tuesday morning, as you were at 11 o'clock this morning, and every day this week, that we will know your presence just as much in our work, other context, as we do here. We meet together to praise and worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please sit down.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.